St. Francis DeSales.
Praise
God. There we go. Getting closer. You're about 20 years in now. St. Francis DeSales.
Praise
God. Thank you. Thank you. We're ready to start, and I'm not processing in because a procession of one is not a procession. It's just a person walking, okay? So we're going to get ready, and Mr. Garrick will get us started. So why don't you please stand?
Good morning once again, and we'd like to welcome you to our annual men and women of St. Francis DeSales Mass, and also our speaker, which will take place after Mass. We thank you for your attendance today, and please join us as we lift our voices during this most holy season of Lent as we approach certainly our Holy Week beginning tomorrow. Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Brothers and sisters, we come together this day to receive the grace and the mercy that we need to live, to know once again the presence of our God, to be refreshed and renewed in His Spirit. To prepare ourselves, let us acknowledge the fact that at times we have not done so well walking close to the Lord. Let us admit that and open ourselves anew to the refreshment of His grace. Lord God, you fashioned us in love at the beginning of time according to your image. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord God, you redeemed us in love in the midst of time by the power of the cross and the glory of your resurrection. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord God, uphold and sustain us in love in this day, in this time, in this moment, by the indwelling of your Holy Spirit. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sin, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, who have made all those reborn in Christ a chosen race and a royal priesthood, grant us, we pray, the grace to will and to do what you command, that the people called to eternal life may be one in the faith of their hearts and the homage of their deeds. Our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
I'm going to work here.
I just shout.
Yeah.
I feel like Goldilocks. You guys still know about Goldilocks?
Start over. The Lord be with you.
Reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Many of the Jews who had come to Mary and seen what Jesus had done began to believe in him, but some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. So the chief priests and the Pharisees convened the Sanhedrin and said, "What are we going to do? This man is performing many signs. If we leave him alone, all will believe in him, and the Romans will come and take away both our land and our nation." But one of them, Caiaphas, who was high priest that year, said to them, "You know nothing, nor do you consider that it is better for you that one man should die instead of the people, so that the whole nation may not perish." He did not say this on his own, but since he was high priest for that year, he prophesied that Jesus was going to die for the nation, and not only for the nation, but also to gather into one the dispersed children of God, so that from that day on they planned to kill him. So Jesus no longer walked about in public among, but he left for the region near the desert in a town called Ephraim, and there he remained with his disciples. Now the Passover of the Jews was near, and many went up from the country to Jerusalem before Passover to purify themselves. They looked for Jesus and said to one another as they were in the temple area, "What do you think? That he will not keep the feast?" The Gospel of the Lord. This is the fifth Sunday, or the Saturday week of Lent. And in the old parlance, I don't know whether anybody here is that old. Don't ever get old, because you leave people behind. You know, I could tell jokes when I first started out as a priest, and people would get them. Now I tell jokes, and people just look at me, "What's he talking about?" And that's because they come from a long time ago. But DeSales High School actually embraces quite a long period of time. Not long enough for me, but a long period of time. That it is something that spanned the distance of time. And when St. Francis de Sales was started, before the changes of the Second Vatican Council, and I hope that's not complete news to anybody, but before that, this time in Lent was called Passion Tide. This whole past week was called Passion Tide, because in the fifth week of Lent, everything in the scripture readings turns towards the passion, towards the suffering of Christ. It turns towards the gospels that are sort of like this one here, where the leaders of the Jewish people were sort of out to get Jesus. They were conspiring. They planned to try and figure out, because they saw him as a troublemaker. They saw him as somebody who would upset their apple cart. And they reasoned that it's better for one person to die than for the Romans to come in and kill us all. It seems like a reasonable kind of thought process. Logical. You want to maximize the good. You want to reduce the danger to everyone. Except it doesn't work. And continually we have had in our history that same kind of thought, that it's better to sacrifice a few than to have everybody suffer. That's not true. And God knows that that's not true. And that's what is behind this week that we're about to enter Holy Week. Because indeed, Christ believes that it's important to save one person. That each and every person is important, invaluable in the vision of God. That you are as important as you way back there in the corner. That we're all loved by God. And that each of us have been gifted with this wonderful thing called life. And that that is so very important. Always to be preserved. Never to be acted against or sacrificed lightly. I say sacrifice lightly because Christ indeed did sacrifice his life. The Jewish official that spoke in the gospel said, Don't you know it's better that one person die than that everybody die? And that's exactly what happened. One person, Christ, died. God died for the sake of everybody. God died as a human being on a cross so that you might live forever. That you might live forever. That's what is coming up in this wonderful Holy Week of the year. So it's an exciting kind of time. And I'm sometimes afraid that the subtlety of Holy Week and the power of Passion Tide are lost on us. It seems as though it's just maybe perhaps one more thing to do. But we know that that's not so. You know that that's not so because you've been connected to this high school for many years. All of you have been connected to this high school from its very beginning, even if you happen not to be that old. Even if you're a student here right now, you've been connected to DeSales High School from its very beginning. You've been connected to all those who went before that came together to bring this school into being. And you're connected to the Church of the Diocese from its very beginning. It doesn't change or break off. It's not something new that's created. It's an old thing that's created in a new way. For example, one of the things that's talked about a lot is civil rights. And when I say the Civil Rights Act, the people of my era, they think of 1964. But you might think also 1968. You might also think 1866. You might also think 1875. You might think 1857. Because the Civil Rights Act has taken place over and over and over again because the message has not sunk down into society that each and every human being is equally important. Endowed by God with inalienable rights. And that we, as believers in Christ, as followers of the Calvary man, we ourselves believe that, but we also live for that. And they're still talking about civil rights. It's not a surprise, because the struggle for justice, the struggle against sin, and the struggle against evil is something that goes on throughout history. One of those things that will always be with us. That's why it's important that you have places where you think about history in terms of the God who sacrificed himself that everybody could live. You think about history in terms of Christ. You think about history in terms of Calvary. You think about history in terms of resurrection. And that's what you do here. Your theme today, I think, is 1960, 2020, 60 years of tradition, 60 years of tradition of charity. I think that's something like that. I'm getting old, so I don't remember everything real well. But I think that's what you're talking about. 60 years of charity. because he told us to. Love one another as I love you. Take care of the poor. Care for those who cannot care for themselves. That's why, that's one of the things you're here to remember. There's so many other things that Mr. DeFault and Mr. Garrett will help us to focus on in just a little bit. Sometimes it can get discouraging because you look at the world and it seems like such a crazy place. We've had shootings again. Some racial involved, perhaps, don't know. Some just coming, flowing out of the quagmire of illness that our world has too much of. But nonetheless, it seems to be a setback. It is not a setback. It is life. It is the life of the world. And as long as you live, there will always be some moment, some time, some event, some happening that's going to require somebody to step up and in the name of God, in imitation of Christ, somebody to step up and do something. Somebody to stand in the breach. Somebody to stand there for someone else. That might be you. As a matter of fact, one day, somehow, it will be you. There'll be something that you're called upon to exercise. And it might be something grand, or it might be simply somebody in a group of people, and everybody's going their other way, and somebody says, wait a minute, we have to help them. And that voice might be yours. That'll be good. Because then this high school would have been worth it. If when you stand in that moment where God needs someone to stand up for him out of love for his people, and you remember that, and you become that, and you speak that, and you act that, then this will have been good. The heritage and the history of St. Francis de Sales High School will have been vindicated and affirmed. I do hope that you make your way to church this coming Holy Week, and you take part in that. Check your parish, whatever it might be, and make sure that you know what's going on, because everything's going to be a little bit different. But we'll be in church. We will have Holy Week, and those events will go on, which last year we couldn't do. To have the people of God somewhere else and have me standing behind an altar in a church by myself didn't feel right. Didn't feel good. It's not going to be that way. I'll be behind the altar this coming week. I'll be behind the altar on Easter. And I pray, God, you all will be in that church too. That you'll be on the other side of the altar. That you'll be giving thanks for the risen Lord, and that you'll be looking for ways in which you might live in the power and the strength and the grace and the love of that same God. Hope you have a good day. Thank you for your involvement with St. Francis de Sales High School. Thank you for coming here as students, and thank you for supporting it as adults, and thank you also for believing in Catholic education, but more importantly, believing in faith. St. Francis de Sales. Ah, oh, you're getting good.
Pope Francis, Bishop Brennan, and especially all the clergy who care for our school, may they
Gracious Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for all the days that have come before that have brought us to this day. But Lord, do not let us become ensnared in the past. We thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you for the days to come, for the blessing of this day to come. But Lord, do not let us worry or fear or become obsessed with the future. Lord God, help us to live fully in this day, in the moment that we have, that it might form us to live strongly and well in faith in all the days to come. We ask and pray this through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Pray, friends, that my sacrifice and yours might be acceptable to God, our Almighty Father. May the offer from our fasting be acceptable to you, O Lord, we pray. And as an explanation, as an expiation for our sins, may they make us worthy of your grace and lead us to what you promise for eternity through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty, our salvation, always, everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For through the saving passion of your Son, the whole world has received a heart to confess the infinite power of your majesty. Since by the wondrous power of the cross, your judgment on the world is now revealed in the authority of Christ crucified. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks. As an exaltation, we acclaim. Thank you. the journey of life. Blessed indeed is your Son, present in our midst when we are gathered by his love, and when as once were the disciples, so now for us he opens the scriptures and breaks the bread. Therefore, Father most merciful, we ask that you send forth your Holy Spirit to sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, that they may become for us the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, on the night of the Last Supper, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, gave the thanks, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
Proclaim the work of your love until he comes again. We offer you the bread of life, the chalice of blessing. Look with favor on the oblation of your church, in which we show forth the paschal sacrifice of Christ that has been handed on to us. Grant that by the power of the Spirit of your love, we may be counted now and until the day of eternity among the members of your Son, in whose body and blood we have communion. Bring your church, O Lord, to perfect faith and charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Robert, our Bishop, with all bishops, priests, and deacons, with the entire people, you have made your own. Open our eyes to the needs of our brothers and sisters. Inspire in us words and actions to comfort those who labor and are burdened. Make us serve them truly after the example of Christ and at his command. And may your church stand as a living witness to truth and to freedom, to peace and to justice, that all people may be raised up to a new hope. Remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the peace of your Christ, especially all the deceased benefactors of St. Francis de Sales High School, our families, our deceased relatives and friends, all the dead, those whose faith you alone have known. Admit them to rejoice in the light of your faith, and in the resurrection give them the fullness of life. Grant also to us, when our earthly pilgrimage is done, that we may come to an eternal dwelling place and live with you forever, there in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the apostles and martyrs, with St. Francis de Sales, with all the saints, we shall praise and exalt you through Jesus Christ, your Son.
Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Amen.
at the Savior's command. Formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin, safe from all distress, and who await the blessed hope of the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, look on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. The body of Christ keep us safe for eternal life. Thank you. majesty most humbly, O Lord, that as you feed us with the nourishment which comes from the most holy body and blood of your Son, so you may make us sharers of his divine nature who lives and reigns forever and ever. Bow our heads and pray for God's blessing. Have mercy, Lord, on your church as she brings you her supplications. Be attentive to those who incline their hearts before you. Do not allow, we pray, those you have redeemed by the death of your only begotten Son to be harmed by their sins or weighed down by their trials, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Our Mass is ended. Live this day in the peace and the mercy of your God.
Good morning once again, and again a big thank you to all who are with us today as we celebrate this traditional event in our calendar, the men and women of DeSales Mass, and typically breakfast. We will get back to that next year. I think everyone understands why we're not able to do that this year, but to celebrate the Mass is really at the heart of what we do, so we thank you being here today. We're going to transition, but before I do that, we transition from a Mass setting, opportunity to hear from our speaker today, and before I establish kind of the parameters for that, I do want to thank Father Petrie for being with us today and presiding over our Mass. Thank you, Father. The pastor of St. Anthony is truly a blessing to both St. Anthony Parish and also to St. Francis de Sales High School. I know that our director of campus ministry is tremendously grateful. Father is here frequently, whether it's Mass, most recently for the Sacrament of Reconciliation this week. Whatever we need, he literally comes and takes care of us. So we are grateful. Know that we thank you very much for that. And I would like to let you know, Father, especially taking time on the eve of Holy Week, that we will also be making a donation to the Student Assistance Fund at St. Anthony in your name to help a young person, a family that may need some help. Leading us today, and also Kat for this time, we're going to transition. We're going to give you about 5 minutes or so to get up and stretch. If you need to use the restroom, we have water in the back. If you'd like to grab the water and bring it in, and then we will get started. I do want to also remind everyone, traditionally, we take up a donation on the occasion of this Mass for Holy Family Food Pantry and Soup Kitchen, where one of our travel alums is the pastor, Father Stosh Daly. And so if you did not have the opportunity as you came, transition this morning. So again, I want to thank you. I want to thank all of you for taking time on this day to attend this annual Women and Men of DeSales Mass and Speaker. I really believe this event captures the essence of what it means to be St. Francis DeSales family. I'd like to thank the Mothers Club for their organization and promotion of this event. I'd like to thank the young women and young men who are here with parents and grandparents, and sisters, brothers, aunts, uncles, and in many instances, mentors. As each of us know, St. Francis de Sales High School has been established on the core values of faith, family, and tradition. It seems fitting to me that we celebrate a Mass annually and sponsor a speaker that focuses on the visionary values of Monsignor Barron, who was entrusted to establish this school 60 years ago with the assistance of the Franciscan Sisters. This is the 60th anniversary of our school. The placement of this event in our calendar also seems very appropriate, in that it falls during the holy season of Lent and on the eve of entering our holy week. During our Lent journey, it seems as if we, in this day and age that we live, sometimes find it difficult to find the time, take the time to reflect prayerfully on the Lent journey. And I thought Father's homily really addressed that. It's so important. And then yesterday, we had Friday morning Mass, and Father Yeager shared a very powerful homily about the importance of silence in our lives. Silence. It's very difficult. We're not accustomed to that. Sometimes silence makes us uncomfortable, but it isn't. It's in the silence that we find a true relationship and get to know God. So it's important that we take the discipline and take the time to silence our hearts and silence our minds when there's so many things competing for our attention. Not only during Lent, but always. I'd like to thank our parents, our fathers and our mothers who were here, and also the grandparents with us as well. What a powerful model of love you serve for each of us. The sacrifices that you make daily, oftentimes unnoticed, except for those who know you and love you deeply. So again, we thank you for that. It's my prayer that the young women and young men who are here take the opportunity frequently to thank those who have given you tremendous gifts. Most importantly, the model of love, the model of Christ's love daily. Everyone present today knows the importance of family, now more than ever. We can point to the pivotal role that a strong family plays in a child's opportunity for success. Moreover, I've always subscribed that the key to any successful community is the strength, courage, grace, and leadership of the adult women and men who model that love for us daily. There's little doubt in my mind that the parents of our community have always and will always serve as their child's primary teacher and role model. Please know that I, along with our faculty, appreciate your daily efforts and thank God for the gift that you have provided us by entrusting your most precious gift, your kids, to our care. From my vantage point as the principal of this special place, this past year has served as an incredible affirmation of who we are as a community. It has been said that adversity introduces a person to him or herself. I think we would all acknowledge the past year has ample introductions. To the young men, I strongly recommend that you pay close attention to the adult women and men in your lives who have been so pivotal in developing you into the people that you are today. I'd also like to take an opportunity to thank our faculty and our coaches who also serve as models each and every day in the classroom and outside of the classroom. And I would be remiss if I did not ask us to take just a moment to pause, to offer a moment of silence and prayer, for those members of our families and the greater SFD family who have gone through the rest. Thank you. I'd also like to thank the following folks who made today possible. I mentioned the Mother's Club, but I especially want to point out co-presidents Jennifer Millenwald and Kelly Pugh. Thank you for your work. I'd also like to thank our faculty liaisons, Antonella and Laura Fowler. Thank you for your efforts as well. Again, thank you to Father Petrie, Ms. Metzger, Mrs. Liz Crumpler and Horizons, and our SFD maintenance team. And a special thank you to Mr. who worked with the coaches to move all craft because he sees the value of this day as well. So thank you, Tom, and your assistant, Aries Cook. And a special thank you to Mr. Adam DeQual, Episcopal Moderator for Education and the Superintendent of Catholic Schools for the Diocese of Columbus, who will be addressing you here momentarily. We are truly blessed, Adam, by your continued support, and Adam as well. I think many of you, we had a great weekend last weekend with our boys basketball team reaching the Final Four. What a lot of people don't know is that Adam was at both those games, Mr. DeQual was at both those games, and Bishop Brennan celebrated confirmation in Portsmouth on Sunday and drove directly to the University of Maryland to be there for the kids. And he's done that on a number of other occasions. So we are truly blessed by the leadership we have in our diocese. And with that, I'd like to just tell you a little bit about Mr. DeQual that you may not already know. First of all, he's the superintendent of our schools. He's the Episcopal Moderator for Education. In this role, he oversees a system of 53 schools. The footprint of the Diocese of Columbus is vast. It's very, very big. He's responsible for overseeing their 16,000 students across 23 counties in Ohio that make up our diocese. He also supervises the Office of Religious Education and Catechesis and the Diocesan Recreation Association. He has held this position since 2018, and I think we would be safe to say that when you initially showed interest in the position, that little did you know that you would be leading us during a global pandemic. So thank you. Mr. DeQual is originally from Chicago. He holds a BS degree from Georgetown University in Washington and an MA in Educational Administration from Dominican University and an MA in Teaching from Dominican University as well. He also is completing his doctorate in Education at Seton Hall University. But probably the thing that he is most proud of, and rightfully so, is he is a loving husband to his wife, Lisa, and they are tremendous parents to their beautiful daughter, Grace. He's a parishioner at St. Bridget of Kildare, Dublin, a certainly distinct pleasure to introduce Adam Duvall as our speaker today. Thank you, Adam.
Because the message of Easter is the same message that drives Catholic education. It's faith. It's our Catholic faith. It's our faith in Jesus Christ and our faith in His Church. As Paul wrote in the first letter to the Corinthians, if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is in vain. And really, it's that faith that has pulled us all together in these 60 years of DeSales history to bring that But this education in faith requires us to have faith in that education. Our Catholic schools are not and cannot be just schools with public curriculum and religion classes attached to it. Our education is a different mission. We are here to form disciples, to educate you and the people who came before you, of course, to know, to love, and to serve God. Prior to getting into the world of central office administration, I had the fortune to be a principal in the Archdiocese of Chicago. I was a principal at a couple of schools for about 10 years. And at one meeting, I heard the late Cardinal George, who I worked far under as a principal, say something that I think sums this up better than anything I've ever heard. And that's that Catholic education is the only truly free education possible. And those of you parents know that doesn't mean tuition or cost. only places where our students can be brought into an education that freely and fully invites God into their lives. Our hope is that you, all of you students who are here today, come to know what is true about our world. Pope St. John Paul II said, "It is only in the mystery of the Word made flesh that the mystery of man truly becomes clear." We have to know ourselves, that fullness of our faith, to understand our world better. And that is the mission of what we do. But we can't do this mission without all of you. Who are called to serve in. People are called into a service at Catholic schools because it's a way of life that they simply cannot not do. And thank God for that. Our principals, our teachers, our coaches, our staff members, all of those people have heard that call and have come to our schools, all 53 of them, and the 6,000 other ones that exist in this country, to serve the church through their work. And they're able to live out their vocation, that call, that special call from the Lord that leads them to a ministry of service. They see their role as bringing that truth to our students every day. And they get that special gift of being able to work, have their work lives and their faith lives connected in a deep and meaningful and public and profound way. There are certainly easier ways to make a living, but I would argue, and I think many of you who are here today that are involved in Catholic education, would argue that there's no better way of doing this. It's a special gift. In his first letter, Peter writes that, and reminds us that our faith will be tested from time to time. We have this great gift, we have this great faith. Into action, we can do amazing things, but there will be times when it is tested. He wrote, "In this, our belief in love of God, you rejoice, although now for a little while you may have to suffer through various trials, of your faith, more precious than gold, that is perishable even though tested by fire, may prove to be for praise, glory, and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ." No more have we seen that testing, probably no better example of that testing, than the year that has been. And it's just over a year now that we've been dealing with this pandemic and this COVID. Certainly, in my 20 years in Catholic education, I've never experienced anything like this. I hope and pray a lot that we never experience anything like this ever, ever, ever again. And honestly, I've yet to talk to anybody who has said that they can top this experience in terms of the intensity and the stress, the uncertainty, and the flat-out workload that it has been to keep Catholic education strong and vibrant through all of these challenges. Back on this, while acknowledging that we're not quite through it, reflecting back on this, we can see how our faith has led us through this, how our faith has directed our steps through all of this, and how it continues to guide us through the ongoing challenges. we discovered how to teach remotely in pretty much an instant, putting in unbelievable hours into planning, strategizing, and organizing our response. At no time did any principal or teacher consider not doing this. It's our ministry and our mission to teach our students, and we wanted to find the best way to do it while preserving educational quality. Our principals met with each other and my staff daily for weeks, sharing strategies and stories, sharing stories and helping each other get through. How do we do this? When is this going to end? What's going to happen in the fall? What is this going to be like? All those millions of questions that no one really had any answers to. But the one thing that we all knew during that time was that we had to reopen our schools. We had to bring our students together in some way, because our Catholic faith demanded it. Our Catholic faith is based on relationship and based on community. Father Ron Nuzzi, a friend of mine and a priest who works at the University of Notre Dame, that I liberally steal from time to time, talks about how Catholic education reflects the Trinity, that God is in relationship, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And what it means to be God is to be in a perfect relationship. It is the nature of God to be in relationship, and it's the nature of relationships to lead us back to God. We hear this when we describe our Catholic schools as families. I know here at DeSales we use that term a lot, and it describes the interactions that you have with your classmates, with your teachers, and it stretches into the history of DeSales, where you have your families. We talk about it with our theater school families. We talk about it with the families here within your schools, and with our connections to your actual families, your families connected to each other. But it's true. We are families in our faith. And if our schools are here to teach that faith, then we need to be here as a family together. And so our faith led us through months of planning to reopen, lots of consultations with medical personnel, lots of time researching and strategizing to develop our plans. And thankfully, all things have gone well so far. Teachers and staff at the school have finished recently getting vaccinated. Many of our, we're working out plans right now to help with vaccinations for 16 and over as the state is opening that up. Hybrid schools are working to return their students to class wherever it's physically possible to do. And we're starting to think more hopefully about the fall. We're still cautious and certainly not announcing anything about the fall today, but we're far more optimistic now than we were a few months ago. And so if Peter is right, and this has been our trial, our faith truly has led us through it, and our faith will make us better on the other side. As we emerge from this, we are also led by our faith to consider the future of the diocese. So expanding out now beyond the DeSales community, beyond our Catholic school community, and into our entire diocesan community. You hopefully have heard about the bishop's initiative for Real Presence and Real Future, which is, as it says on the nice banners that are around our school and around our parishes, that it's a time and a call for us to increase the presence of Christ throughout our diocese and to uphold the faith for future generations. It's an initiative that's calling for renewal and reinvigoration and revitalization of our diocese. DeSales, again, you're celebrating 60 years. DeSales was first built at the last big boom that we had in Catholic education. Many of our parishes, many of our schools were built around 1960, somewhere, give or take a few years. And it was because of this big boom and numbers of Catholics in our community. We haven't changed a whole lot structurally in our diocese since then, but our time to do that now is now. This initiative that we have is a time to refocus our diocese, our schools, and our parishes, and ourselves on the love of Jesus, and to do as St. Catherine of Siena famously said, unity, and you will set the world on fire. St. Francis of Sales said something similar. I see that. You've seen that. For the schools, engaging in this initiative has been through a strategic planning process. We've been working hard to imagine the seems like a lot, but it's really, but we have made great progress in this, and we look forward to sharing more details in the future, because we'd be back of making sure that our schools are here well into the future. That St. Francis de Sales has another 60 years to serve, another 60 years of alumni, another 60 years of parents, and continuing that tradition of what makes this school so wonderful and so special. And so here, and just to say that Catholic schools have an incredibly important role to play in the future of our diocese and in our faith. Throughout the Paschal Mystery that we will celebrate this week, we'll be reminded of the suffering, the death, and of the resurrection of Jesus. As a world, we've been through quite a fair amount of suffering and death in this past year. But in the end, there is resurrection. In the end, God is here with us. And his real presence was with us today as we celebrated Mass together. We will continue to move through the challenges led by that unshakable faith in our Lord, who in 1 week will celebrate rising again. It is that faith that is, as Paul again tells us, that is the realization of what is hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Thank you all again for being here today and for listening. And as we said, there's great things ahead for all of our Catholic schools as we emerge out of this challenging and difficult year and look forward to a wonderful future. Let me once again just thank all of you for your support of Catholic education in this wild year. To our staff and our teachers, you're simply amazing, and I don't know what we would have done without you. Thank you for your trust and your support and your dedication to our schools. And for our students, our hope is that we've served you well in this challenging year. We're certainly looking forward to better days, but we thank you for all that you've done to help us make this year possible and to educate you in our schools and to keep things going. So, once again, thank you all. I hope you have a wonderful rest of the weekend and a very blessed Easter. Thanks again.
Wrap up here. First of all, I'd like to thank Mr. Fault for his words. Certainly, truly blessed by your leadership and on a personal level, your friendship for us, your support. We sense that on a daily basis. I can't imagine a more fitting speaker. We celebrate our 60th anniversary and we are at the culmination of some challenges, so thank you for that. And I would also like to let you know on behalf of our school community, we will be making a donation to the Diocesan Tuition Assistance Fund. I asked Mr. Duvall if he had a prized charity that he and his wife were especially close to. He thought for about maybe 2 seconds, and he said, let's help our kids. So we will do that in your name. So thank you for that. I also have just a small token for both Father Petrie and Adam, who wouldn't mind coming up, for your time today. So if you wouldn't mind joining me up here. girls, 471-008. 471-008. Anybody get it? This is a Spiritware 929-449. 929-449. Dan Horvath. Another Spiritware 929-453. 929-453. Brandon Heil, congratulations. Chipotle gift card. Time for lunch. 471-0-471-005. Congratulations. 9513. Go Gans. TK Maxx gift card. I'll tell you what, our mother's club does a great job. 929-521. Congratulations, and I believe that is